Okay, so we can start this session now. Okay, so the first talk will be about the resolution of Keller's conjecture, and it will be given by Martin Hull.
Thank you for the introduction. Greetings here from Amsterdam. So in this talk, I will show our results of solving the remaining case of Keller's conjecture, a mathematical challenge that has been open for almost a century. We solve it with massively parallel automated reasoning combined with extensive symmetry breaking. This is joint work with Josh Brackensieck, John Mackey, and David Narvaez. In this talk, I will cover the following topics. So first, a brief history of Keller's conjecture. Keller's conjecture is about a tiling in the continuous space, and we first need to make it discrete and to apply automated reasoning, and therefore we have the concept of Keller graphs. We built on top of various papers on Keller graphs and finding maximum cliques in those graphs. Our approach works on translating this into satisfiability. We have a special, very compact encoding for this. Not only did we solve the problem, we also produced a proof such that to increase confidence in our result. This proof does not only include all the search, but also all the symmetry that we did. And I end this talk with some experimental results, conclusions, and directions for future work. First, a brief history of Keller's conjecture. So Keller's conjecture is about tiling. So first, consider an easy case. So we have, say, the entire two-dimensional space, or for example, a floor that we want to tile with square tiles, and all tiles have the same size. And now the question is it the case that if you have a gap-free tiling using these tiles, that it's always the case that two tiles are fully connected? And if you think about it a bit, then you kind of come to the conclusion that there's only one way of tiling, and which is actually to have these, to have lanes with tiles in the same lane, and the lanes apart can be arbitrarily shifted from each other, but all the tiles in two lanes, so two consecutive tiles, have a fully shared edge, like the one that we see over here. If we now go to the three-dimensional case, then it becomes slightly more difficult, and I don't have time to go fully in detail, but something quite similar arises. And for example, if you see the partial tiling of with unit cubes of the three-dimensional space shown on the slide on the right, then the only way to continue this tiling is to have a fully connected face sharing face on the blue, where the blue faces are. And so this pattern holds, this pattern, which is if you have a gap-free tiling with equally sized square cubes, then there are two cubes that have a completely full face sharing edge of a face. And Keller actually conjectured it is not only hold for the second and the third dimension, but he conjectured that it holds for any dimension. And so Keller's conjecture is that for all n larger and equal than one, every tiling of the n-dimensional space with unit cubes has two cubes which fully share an n minus one dimensional face. Now, what is the result so far for Keller's conjecture? So a decade later, Perron showed that Keller's conjecture is true for the dimensions up till six. After that, there was very little progress for many decades. And it took until 92 that there was a breakthrough by Jeff Lekarius and Peter Shor that they actually found a counterexample for Keller's conjecture for the 10th dimension. And if you have a counterexample for dimension n, you can easily make a counterexample for n plus one. So they actually showed that Keller's conjecture was false for all dimensions larger or equal than 10. And 10 years later, John Mackey actually improved their result by finding a counterexample for Keller's conjecture in the eighth dimension. And so if you summarize these results, then the only remaining case that's still there is the case with the dimension seven. Is Keller conjecture true or false for dimension seven? And this is what we showed in our paper. So the main result is that Keller's conjecture is true in dimension seven. And this fully resolves now all cases for this conjecture. So Keller's conjecture is true for the dimensions 1 to 7 and false for all the higher dimensions. Our approach, which I will talk about in the next slides, is we actually translate the Keller conjecture into a Max Klick question of the so-called Keller graphs. And we solve this Max Klick problem using satisfiability solving. Our encoding is actually quite compact, but even the compact encoding was still difficult to solve, and we required extensive symmetry breaking to make the problem feasible. Besides solving the problem, we also constructed a proof. The proof is quite large. It's about 200 gigabytes in size. However, we also were able to verify it with a formally verified checker. Okay. Now, so how are we going to kind of do automated reasoning on Keller's conjecture? And the key concept here are Keller graphs. First, we are going to find cliques in these graphs, and a clique is simply a fully connected subgraph. What are these Keller graphs? So the Keller graphs are denoted by G sub and S. It has two parameters, N, which is the number of dimensions, and S, which is the so-called shift. The Keller graph has 2s to the power n vertices, and each vertex represents a cube. So we will use the words vertices and cubes at the same time. And we are looking for graphs with dimension 7, so n is 7. And already for small s, you can see that these graphs are very big. So each of these vertices has n dimensions. We will represent the dimensions by dots, and each dot is colored, and we will use 2s colors, and the colors come in s complementary pairs. So for example, example of complementary pair is black and white. Another example of a complementary pair of colors is red and green. Okay, so we have 2s to the power n vertices. What about the edges? So two vertices are connected if and only if two properties hold. The first property is that in one dimension, they should have a pair of complementary colors. And the second property is that they should differ in another dimension in colors. Let me show this by an example. Here we see a cube with white and red. This is connected to a cube with green and green. Why? Because green and red are complementary, and white and green are different. Similarly, white and red is connected to black and black because white and black are complementary, and green and red and black are different. Green and green and black are not connected. They have two different colors, but there is no complementary pair. And Corradi and Szabo showed that if Keller's, such a graph, G sub n s, has a clique of 2 to the power n, then there is a counterexample for Keller's conjecture in dimension n. So notice that this is only one direction, right? If there is such a clique, there is a counterexample. If there's no such a clique, it doesn't necessarily be the case that it actually holds. And we will explore the other direction in future slides. I just want to show you this image to kind of give you the impression of how these graphs look like. So this is Keller graph with dimension 2 and shift 2. This is a graph with 16 vertices, and as you can see, this graph is 5 regular. And Keller conjectures would have been false for dimension 2 if there would have been a clique of size 4 in this graph. As you can see, there is no such clique. In fact, there is not even a clique of size 3. There's no triangle in this graph. This graph has also a lot of structure, and we will exploit this structure in our approach. So what has been the progress for dimension 7? There's actually been quite some work in this direction in the last decade. An important result was by Jennifer DeBroni and others that showed that the graph with dimension 7 and two complementary colors has size 124. But in order to know that Keller's conjecture is actually true in dimension 7, based on the old results actually dating back to the 1940s, you actually have to show this for the Keller graph with dimension 7 and 64 complementary colors, which is an enormous graph. But what we actually are able to do is, because we're actually going to use Lisa Kauska and Kieslowicz's work from 2013 to 2017, that actually shows that you can use a much smaller graph. And actually, if you use G73, G74, or G76, and you can show that there is no clique of size 128 in one of those graphs, then Keller's conjecture is true for dimension 7. And this is actually what we're going to do. We're going to show that none of these graphs has a clique of size 128. Okay, now we're going to encode this maximum clique, or whether this clique of 128 exists, as a solved problem. So this is the, I think, a key technical slide, and this kind of shows our approach. So on the left, we see back again this graph with dimension 2 and shift 2, this graph with 16 vertices. And the graph for higher dimensions becomes bigger and bigger and bigger. And finding already finding a max clique in such a graph with the classical max clique encoding to SOT would be very difficult. Instead, we have a much more compact representation. And what we use is the following observation. So the graph that we see on the left can be actually partitioned. And not only this graph, but any Keller graph can be partitioned into 2 to the power n, n is in a dimension, independent groups of independent sets. And we call these independent sets groups. For example, there is a partitioning shown on the right side of the slide. So we see here white, white, green, green, white, and green, green. They form an independent set. And we can also form the other 3 independent sets. And based on this observation, it's kind of clear that the maximum clique in Keller graph with dimension n can be 2 to the power n, because you can use at most 1 from each group. And what we're going to do is actually we merge these groups into kind of a symbolic cube. And so, for example, here we have this the symbolic cube where both of the dots can be either white or green. And so we merge them in these symbolic cubes. And now we ask the satisfiability problem, can we make this a concrete cube in such a way that we have all the 6 edges that are required for a clique of size 4? And so instead of reasoning about this big graph, although this one is reasonably small, but in other dimensions, they are getting really big, we're going to reason about this much smaller representation, which is a key to solving this open case for Keller's conjecture. So how do we encode it further? So instead of trying to find a clique in the big graph, we're going to build a clique by picking a vertex from each group. We use Boolean variables that encode that vertex V at dimension D as color C. And we only have kind of 3 constraints, which we then translate to clauses. The first constraint is simply that every dimension, every dot, must have exactly 1 color. And the second and third are constraints are actually enforcing that we have all the edges. And so what we need for the second constraint is that for each pair of vertices, they should have a complementary colors in some dimension. And then if we combine it with the third constraint, such that for every pair of vertices, they must have a different color in some other dimension, then together the second and the third constraint and make sure that we have all the edges. Additionally, we use some auxiliary variables to make sure that we can encode these constraints very compactly as a propositional formula. Just to give you a little impression regarding the size, so we are going to consider these three graphs, G37, G74 and G76. And in the second column here, we see the number of vertices or the number of cubes. In the third column, we see the number of variables, but the most important thing here is the last column, which is the number of clauses. And observe that the number of clauses that we have is actually less than the number of vertices in the graph. If we would have used a traditional max clique encoding, then the number of clauses would have been significantly more than the number of vertices. So you can imagine that these formulas would have been much bigger. So our encoding really is, it's still, let's say 200 to 400,000 clauses, but it is much more compact and actually feasible given the additional things that I will present in this part of the talk. Okay, so we not only solved the problem, but we also constructed a proof. I cannot go too much into detail here, but I just want to give you some flavor of what's going on. So on the left of the slide, you see a formula. A formula is simply a set of clauses. And on the right, we see a proof. And you can see this as a sequence of clauses. And in order to check whether a proof is correct, we add them one by one to the formula and check whether the addition of a clause from the proof preserves satisfiability. So first we add the first clause, then the second one, then the third, until the final one. If the final clause is the empty clause, which by definition is unsatisfiable, then the original formula is also unsatisfiable by transitivity. It is important that we can check that we can add these clauses in polynomial time. And today, SAT solvers can easily emit such proofs. Not only can we express all the reasoning that happens in the SAT solvers here, but we also use extensive symmetry breaking. And also, the symmetry breaking is expressed in the same proof. How does this symmetry work? So I first explained a bit on a high level with an example. So on the left, we see our four symbolic cubes. And the question is, can we find a concrete coloring such that we have all the six edges? What we can do with symmetry breaking is that we pick, for example, one of the cubes, say we pick this top right one, and we fix both of its colors, and we make them both black. That we can do for symmetry breaking. And then we can pick for another cube, which has the two the same dots, we can pick one of them and say we pick the bottom left one and make it white. After you do this symmetry breaking on this small example, then it actually becomes trivial to solve. Okay, now back to the big graph. Is our symmetry breaking consists of three parts. The first part is the only part that we don't verify because it was too complicated. But we do have a pen and paper proof of this first part in our article. And what does it, this first part do is say we can assume without loss of generality that we have the cube in our clique with which is the fully black one. And we have also another one which is fully black except one of the dimensions is white and the other dimension is red. The second part of our symmetry breaking is that we can actually assume that we have these four additional cubes. This part of the symmetry breaking is actually part of our clausal proof. Notice there are a few so-called rainbow dots, and these rainbow dots are free. So we don't know the color of them. The third part of our symmetry breaking is that we enumerate all the possibility for these 13 rainbow dots. And then we filter out all the isomorphic ones. Let us have a more detailed look at this filtering. So given these six cubes, we have 13 rainbow cubes. So in worst case, we have S to the power R, where R stands for the number of rainbow cubes, options to color them. However, these can be significantly be reduced if you use symmetry breaking. So for S is 3, we only need 21,000 cases. For S is 4, 37,000. For S is 6, 38,000, which is substantially smaller than if we wouldn't use any filtering. These are the numbers shown over here. And also in this third part, we express the entire symmetry breaking in the clausal proof, and this has been checked with the checker. We observed that for all S3, S4, S6, there was one case which was significantly harder than all the other cases. And in order to have the parallelization being more smooth, we split that specific cube or case into a few thousand smaller cases. Okay, now let's continue with the experimental results. So we solved each of these cases or subproblems using the state-of-the-art SatSolver catechol, and we run all the experiments in parallel using Xeon processors with 24 cores. We had 50 such machines, and we also used catechol's feature to output proofs in the so-called DRAD format. In a next step, we optimize these proofs. And then we use a formally verified checker called ACL2Check to certify these optimized proofs. Now, first, let us consider the case for S is 3. And the plot looks like this. This is a so-called cactus plot. On the horizontal axis shows the number of cases or subformulas that have been solved if the timeout would have been the one shown on the vertical axis. So here, notice the logarithmic scale. And so what you see here is that, say, 70% of the cases, 75% of the cases, the SatSolver can be solved. We can optimize the proof and we can certify the proof within a second. Of the remaining cases, most of them can actually be solved, optimized, and certified in 10 seconds. And what we see here is that there are a few hard ones and they can have a runtime up to say an hour. And if you run this on say 50 machines, then we can actually have a wall clock runtime of about an hour. Now, if we shift to SS4, we see that actually about 80% of the cases can be solved within a second. Again, most other ones can be solved in 10 seconds, and actually a few of them are harder. And actually there now we have a few cases that actually took a few hours. So it was a slightly more time, wall clock time to solve it. And the case for SS6 was slightly easier because, as you can see here again, most of them solved in 1 second, the other ones most solved in 10 seconds, and the hardest ones for SS6 turned out to be only kind of taking an hour. Now to conclude, so we solved the case of dimension 7 for Keller's conjecture, which now fully solves this long-standing conjecture. And we now know that Keller's conjecture holds for dimension 1 to 7, and it doesn't hold for any higher one. We showed this because we showed that there is no clique of size 128 in G7-3, G7-4, and G7-6. One of the key components was to have a very compact SAT encoding and combined with massively parallel automated reasoning and extensive symmetry breaking. Not only that we constructed solved the problem, but also constructed a proof that includes both all the search and the symmetry breaking, and we certified this proof using a formally verified checker. Regarding directions for future work, there's actually quite some interesting directions. One of the things that we pursue is actually to have a full formal proof of Keller's conjecture. So most of the things we did, we have now formally verified because of the formally verified checker, but several parts still needs to be formalized. For example, the Keller's conjecture need to be formalized. Also, the relationship between Keller's graphs and the conjecture needs to be proven to be correct. And we also need to prove the correctness of our compact encoding. There are also still several questions that are still open. For example, what is the largest clique in G73, G74, and G76? We know it's at least 124 and at most 127. Can we compute the exact value? There is a clique of 256 in G82 due to Mackie. And the question is this clique unique? Modulo symmetries. And another question is, so why is there a transition going on from, if we go from dimension 7 to dimensions 8? This is also completely not clear yet. And I would like to end my talk by actually showing an illustration of the clique by John Mackie from 2002. So here we see the 256 cubes. And you can check that for every pair of them, it holds that there is an edge between them. So they differ, they have a complementary pair in one dimension, and in another dimension, they have at least one different color. That concludes my talk. I'm happy to answer questions.
Okay, so we all thank Brian for his very, very nice talk, and we are open to questions. Please raise a hand in Zoom to ask questions, please. And try to do that before, in advance. So I cannot see any raised question. Raise a hand. Actually, I start, so I start to break some ice. My question is, okay, so you present this to SAT, but have you presented or discussed with mathematicians or to the domain experts, and what did they think about that?
So we also discussed this with colleagues, and for example, the our colleagues in Poland that have been working on also on trying to solve the seventh dimension, and they really think it's cool that how we were able to do it. They actually also explored SAT. I don't know what kind of encoding they've been using, but I think the key thing is that we were able to make it small and to actually solve it. But in general, I've been now working on several math problems and solve them using SAT. And I noticed that lots of mathematicians are very excited about the possibility of doing this. And especially also in combination that we have these proofs such that we can have fully confidence in the correctness.
Okay, so there is a question from Ankita Sukhya, who is allowed to talk.
Hi, Marijn. So this symmetry breaking, so how do you implement it? Is it the standard symmetry breaking predicate from SAT, or is there something fancy?
To some extent, it is similar to symmetry breaking clauses, although we have did them very specifically, but The key challenge here was not to add the right clauses, but to construct the DRED proof that shows the correctness of the addition. So it is, let me, because actually if you use a tool like Shutter to do the symmetry breaking, then the result is not as strong as ours, because you also have to pick the right cubes for actually for breaking the symmetries on. automated tools will pick, say, the first ones, and the ones that you actually need to do the symmetry breaking on are specific ones.
Okay, thank you.
I think I have one more question, since I don't see anybody else. You mentioned in your future work the idea of formalizing the Kellner's conjecture in general. Can you mention exactly what does it mean? So it means doing a proof by induction or what?
No, so we have in a theorem prover like Isabel or Koch or Lien, we have a statement that first we have the statement what is Keller's conjecture, and then we have a statement in those theorem provers that say, okay, for dimension 1 to 7, this is true, and for dimension 8 and up, this is false. And so we have everything in a single system.
Okay. There is also, I see a question in the written question answer section by Jeremy Avigad, who says, is there any significance to the one very hard case? So the one that had to be split by hand?
Yes. So the significance. So we still need to stop. But actually, the case where it is. So you see here the cubes, and the one that is the case that is the hardest one is very symmetric. So both these dots are white. All these three dots are white, three of these dots are white, and one is red, and three of them are white, and one is red. So the one that is most symmetric, that is the one that is actually the hardest case. And so that's probably not a coincidence. And it's also the nice thing about it is that since it is very symmetric, it leaves many other symmetries open. So we were able to do a lot of filtering on the remaining cases. Because there's lots of symmetries left if you color them. In this case, for all of these three, we have two whites here, or three whites, and then one red, one green. Yeah, so it was the specific case was in all cases exactly the same one, which uses only the four colors that we shown on the slide, although you could use multiple colors. And this is the most symmetric case.
Okay, I think it's time to close this section, and thanks our speaker again. So there is no recorded clapping, of course, so let me do it for everybody.